That's just the opening of my song that I'm contributing to the psychotronic warfare and criminal intent of stalkers in the world, both high-tech, spiritual sorcerers, murderers. We'll play it later in its entirety because it talks about targeted individuals and all that stuff that we're going to be getting into this hour, but I don't want to waste another minute here. What I need to do is I need to find my... Oh, yes, it's a very accomplished song, and we'll get into that later. But first, and as I promised, and as we talked about last hour, A New Breed, Satellite Terrorism in America by Dr. John Hall. And he's on a radio station at RBM with a colleague, Don Raumaker. And what I want to do, and I hope I pronounced that right, because I'm going to be bringing them on as soon as I can find my little Skype thing. I'm going to be bringing them on right now because we're going to talk about gang stalking, terror, satellite terror, high-tech, really spiritual warfare by really spiritual high-tech occultic witchcraft going high-tech, and targeted individuals. You've heard me talk about this for years, but now I'm actually fashioning it into a language that we can all really understand. So without further ado, welcome, gentlemen, to the Z Live of the Zeph Report. Are you there?
Zeph, how you doing? This is Dr. John Hall. Hey, I got to ask you, is that some of your work there on the intro song?
That was, yeah, that's a whole song that I wrote just recently because of this topic coming into view here.
Pretty cool. It kind of has a Trent Reznor kind of feel to it, you know, Nine Inch Nails.
And it has lyrics that eventually, like, talk about targeted individuals in the psychic realm, and then it talks about, I had a word for people, just earlier that the wrath of God is definitely on these people. I'm not going to make any bones about that. You cross a certain line with the Lord, and that's it.
Amen.
Is that Don? Hello.
That's what. We really appreciate you allowing us to be on your show. I wasn't familiar with your work, and just when John told me that you had invited him to come on the show, I did a little research, and I just you fall right in line with exactly what we're doing.
So, and you're fighting the fight,
you're
man.
Fighting
and that's
the fight,
important.
I don't know if John told you, but my of course John is a physician, and I've mm-hmm. got a doctorate degree in divinity. I've got a master's degree in theology and a doctorate degree in divinity. So my background, but much like yours, I was in the entertainment business for 20 some odd years. Mm-hmm. And not as an entertainer, but I had a recording studio and a record company and radio stations and dance halls and that type of stuff.
Yeah.
And that's one reason that John and I have been friends for a while, but the one reason why I got involved with John is because this is a spiritual warfare. What's going on is... we talk about this continuously on our show about, folks need to get on their face and pray that, that we can overcome this evil that's going on in our world.
Yeah. No, this is the most evil of all things, and it's the scariest of all things, and it's been happening to me since I was a teenager, but I didn't understand what it was.
What we've found, Zeph, is there are a lot of folks that felt like that, they were suffering from manic depression, or they were suffering from PTSD, or they were suffering from schizophrenia. In reality, they were TIs. They were targeted individuals. They were being attacked by either, microwave technology or some type of electronic mind control. And because a lot of the symptoms for a TI or a targeted individual, it's very, very similar to somebody with PTSD.
Yeah, and that's particularly done with intention. I mean, the whole point of that technology is to mimic mental illness, because that ends up parking you in front of a psychiatrist who diagnoses you as delusional or schizophrenic.
Yeah,
and that's all there is.
And then you're at that point marginalized, and your credibility is gone. And so no matter what you say, they can always just write you off as being crazy.
Absolutely.
And it's unfortunate because, like I tell a lot of the victims, most of the victims of this technology are also victims of organized stalking. I know you'll notice I use the term organized stalking instead of gang stalking. Mm-hmm. I don't mislead the public. And when you say gang stalking, a lot of people picture, you know, the guys in leather jackets and,
you know,
warriors type of thing. And it's really not, you know, a gang per se, but it's an organized form of stalking. So that is my only reason for using that terminology.
Okay, OG, I'll pick that up myself now and start calling it organized stalking, and they also call it cause stalking or vigilante stalking, but this is more organized. Now, I have a question for both of you, and that is, this is what we asked last hour, and, you know, we really can't, it's hard to come up with the answer. I mean, there's probably a spiritual answer to it, but it's why? 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 It's like the Enron commercial.
I'll let Dr. Hall share his theory, and then I'll share mine.
Okay. Well, my theory on it is, if you know, through Freedom from Covert Harassment and Surveillance, a human rights group that I sit on the medical board of, we've done extensive surveys. We've got another survey coming out. What we found in our surveys of the victims is that there is no common thread. You know, a lot of people, you know, will say, well, it must be whistleblowers. It must be people who worked for government. It must be radicals. And that's not true. What we found is that it's a purely random sample of the population that's being victimized. The only common thread is that 70% of the victims are female, and of that 70%, almost 100% are complaining of sexual assault, as well as the stalking, the break-ins, and the electronic harassment. In my mind, and my theory is that the people that are being victimized by this are actually guinea pigs or test subjects for a larger picture of global control, new world order, one world government. Make sure it's going to work on a smaller subset of the population before you start controlling the entire population with it.
Right.
Guns and taxes will only control people so far. This technology has the ability to control everyone.
Yeah, so they get off the hook. In other words, they can, you know, hit you with all this, and then there's no place you can go for redress, obviously, because it's inside your head, and it's in your health, if you will. And but here's okay. Here's something that happened to me. And I'm adjusting my settings here, so I'm trying to get this all even here as I'm on the mixing board and doing. Yeah, I'm like an octopus here doing all this. But okay, so I'm in Los Angeles, and it's happening. You know, they're the break-ins that you talk about in the book. What happened to my book? Trish, where's my book? Okay, A New Breed, Satellite Terrorism in America by Dr. John Hall. A great book. And you have a lot of things that, well, I didn't do what you did. In other words, you found the cameras. You found the, it was only later that I knew about it, like the house being wired. And people would be, like I'd go to a store or something. They would be there ahead of me, doing some kind of, you know, low-level harassment of me in an organized fashion between, say, five or six individuals. Then, okay, we went on a vacation to Maui. And I told this to you on when we talked the other day on the phone. I just said, okay, so, and the people out there have heard this before. I go to the bar because we can't, we're waiting on a table for four of us. And I'm at the bar. The guy comes right up to my mug, and he just goes, "We know who you are." Like, letting me know that the hey, it didn't stop in L.A. It's still going on here in Maui.
Wow.
Does that sound paranoid?
And, you know, a lot of the victims do complain of their stalkers actually following them, you know, across state lines and getting on planes. You know, that doesn't necessarily have to happen, because this, at least from talking to government sources that I mentioned in the book, most of this is being done via satellite and via HARP. And there's really, you know, they can do the electronic harassment to you wherever you go, on a plane, on a boat. You know, we're in Texas. Mm-hmm. We had, you know, victims on, you know, 6,000 acre ranches in the middle of nowhere where there's no electric power lines, there's no cell phone coverage, and they still hear the voices, they still get attacked. In writing the book, I talked to two friends, one on the FBI, one on the CIA, who are, you know, ethical guys, and, you know, they were kind enough to share how the technology works with me. And one of the CIA guys admitted, yeah, we can see you inside your home with thermal imaging, FLIR imaging, and X-ray imaging. And, yes, there are directed energy weapons on the system, ultrasound, microwave, laser, and particle beam. But it's, in his words, a weapon of war for use abroad. Well, obviously, that leaves really, you know, a couple of conclusions, that this technology is being criminally accessed by hackers, and the government just doesn't want to admit the extent of the technology of being able to decode your thought and place thoughts in your head for fear of what the public would do. The better scenario is that it's an agency sterile operation, experimentation, where certain criminal groups have been given access to this technology that don't directly work for a government agency. That way there's plausible deniability if those people get caught. And that is the more likely scenario.
You talked about at one point the fact that people do go crazy when they're targeted because they don't understand why. And then they're convinced by other people they better go see the shrink. They better go to get some therapy. They better, you know, and eventually they start acting out all the symptoms of someone who's a psychotic.
Well, you know, this technology really works in two ways, two fundamental ways. One form of it is for harassment. Those are the people hearing the voices, being attacked with directed energy, experiencing the break-ins. The other form of the use of this technology is through behavioral control and mind control. Now, if you're one of the controlled individuals, you're never going to know it. I mean, you're not being broken into, you're not being attacked, you're not hearing voices. You know, you're basically having your thoughts controlled and your behavior modified. What we found with almost all of the victims is that before they decide to target the person that's chosen to be attacked, they make sure to already be controlling that person's social support network. So if they've watched you long enough to know that, you know, really the only two important people in your family are your parents or your significant other, they'll be sure to be controlling that person before they attack the other. And in most scenarios that are sexual assault based, usually it's the woman that's being controlled in the relationship while the male is hearing voices, being attacked, and noticing the break-ins. Well, obviously, he's going to turn to his significant other for support and say, you know what, we're under surveillance, we're being watched, the house is being broken into. While the female is being controlled to say, no, I just don't see it. I don't think it's going on. I think it's in your head. And it's almost always a family member or a part of the social support network that recommends that person see a psychiatrist. The reason it's done that way, at least in the cases where it's in, like in my case, where it's sexual assault based, and 70% of the other cases that I've talked to, that's to pull the male out of the home and leave the woman vulnerable. Someone who's being controlled, and as I wrote in the book, they can put Rohypnol or GHB, date rape drugs, in food stuff or water or, you know, drinks in the home and control that person to eat or drink where the drugs are. Then that allows these, you know, you rent apartments or condos or around that victim, wait till the drug takes effect, and that person is an easy target for sexual assault. So most of the time, that's the type of scenario we see, where one person's being victimized and one person's being controlled.
Gosh, it just, what do you do with your anger here? it's unbelievable. Now, Don, you were in the entertainment industry, and I can tell you that a lot of the people that are, say, celebrities, musicians, you know, artists of all kinds, filmmakers, whatnot, they a lot of them to me seem controlled, you know, just, you know, to, maybe it's a financial thing, but I mean, they don't seem free at all. A lot of the ones who are working quite a bit.
Well, and I tell people all the time that group of folks, God bless them, but that the group of entertainers that I've been associated with in the film industry and the music business, they're so dysfunctional that it'd be hard for me to discern whether or not they were insane or they were being controlled because of their lifestyle and so forth. And I think there are, I firmly believe that the movers and shakers, that the people that are calling the shots in the entertainment business, in the music industry anyway, I feel like that they are being controlled because of the just the way that they live their lives and the way they do business and the demands that they put on the entertainers or actors or musicians or whatever. And also it's, you know, I think part of the control is the financial aspect of it. But as well as I do, Zeph, that they are, you know, they're completely and totally, 90% of them are godless, dysfunctional individuals, and they very well could be controlled. So,
Well, yeah, because what I've known about, well, people that I've sort of, you know, grown up with, if you will, that wound up being more or less the movers and shakers of all that, they were, you know, targeted as children and put into satanic abuse situations as children, generational abuse and all that. You've heard about that, I'm sure. And I think that ties right in with this scenario as well. You know, in other words, if any of those children were to rebel, let's say, and they're supposed to become cash cows at some point and be tortured so that they can, you know, perform, you know, trauma-based control ends up almost torturing a kid into being a genius at something. What ends up happening if they rebel or try to get free is then, you know, then you get this whole wrath of this whole system coming down on their heads. You know, the mental hospital, the psychiatrist, the drugs, you know, the suicides, the, you know, the famous people being suicided, as, if you will. The famous ones being like, you know, Jimi Hendrix, you know, Jim Morrison, the whole Laurel Canyon fiasco, the music, all that stuff is all right. Part of this, isn't it, in some way?
Well, and you know, the entertainment business is really has a lot of drug problems within it. And, you know, drugs are a form of control. And even more importantly, this particular type of technology, especially ELF wave and microwave induced EEG and brain changes, mm-hmm. can augment addictive personality. And that's been shown in the lab for a long time now. That's nothing new to the science world. But you can stimulate the pleasure centers of the brain and actually augment addictive personality where it already exists. It's easy to do. I've seen it in victims of this technology. Saw it in my ex-fiance. She was basically a non-drinker. When she started exhibiting signs of control, started drinking near fatal amounts of alcohol, which was their goal, after their identities were brought forth to the police. And she finally had gynecologic exams and we had proof of the rape. They basically started controlling her into drinking, you know, suicidal amounts of alcohol. And I think that is one of the things that we see with the drug counterculture is, you know, they make easy guinea pigs. For one, drugs automatically discredit you. If you go to the police with any claims of this stalking or electronic harassment and you have a drug problem in addition, it will get written off to as part of the drug problem. Now, on the backside of that is the drug problem is also probably being augmented by the same people who are using the technology on you. So it's a double-edged sword and a vicious cycle, and that's why I always tell the victims that get a hold of me, if you're using any type of illegal drugs, make sure you stop, because, you know, before you go to the police, before you try to make any reports on the stalking, make sure there's nothing like that that you're doing, because they will write it off to the drugs. And it's very easy to stimulate the areas of the brain to augment addictive behavior.
You know, well, I've fallen into that category, I have to admit.
So,
you know.
I'll tell you, also, when you have this type of control, and obviously it's either the movers and shakers, it's governmentalist, New World Order, whatever handle you want to put on it. But what I feel is going on is, especially with this, the younger generation of musicians and actors and actresses and so forth, they're controlling these people and they're doing all kinds of bizarre things, the Lohans and the Kardashians and you know, just all the silliness that's going on. And part of that is, if it is governmental control, if it is a New Age control situation, it's smoke and mirrors. They're trying to take John Q. Public's mind off what really is going on, about how their lives are being completely and totally controlled by having Lindsay Lohan blasted all over the TV, telling, you know, what woman she's sleeping with or whatever. And it's just a form of smoke and mirrors, basically.
Yeah, and that's real evidence, Zev. If you get you can go to MSN, click on the top 10 stories. The top 10 stories that the public are actually viewing on any of the news websites. And it won't be what Supreme Court justice is being nominated or what's going on in Washington, D.C., or, you know, it won't be anything important. The top 10 stories will be Lindsay Lohan, Britney Spears, the Kardashians, you know, what's going on in the entertainment world.
Mm-hmm. No, it's it's a menagerie, sort of, you know, the entertainment world is like its own Alice in Wonderland matrix. It doesn't have any rhyme or reason, but people just will do any. I mean, they will pay you to take their soul, basically. People that want to get in and be stars, there's a huge competition for that. And it's heartbreaking to see what happens to people, you know, because the public just sees, you know, those few stars that are out there. And, oh, they have these troubled lives, and that makes it all the more interesting for the gossip rags and all that. But the people that aren't are trying to get in, and everything, they're all their ego and their whole life is wrapped up into being a star. And then they don't make it. And, of course, then there's drugs and alcohol and all that and, you know, prostitution and all these things that come in. And that's the criminal element that's around, you know, sports, and it's around politics, and it's around, you know, it's around entertainment. Let's face it. You know, where there's big money, you're going to have a criminal element. And then they exploit these people in whatever way they can. Prostitution being one way, human trafficking, slavery. And we know I've done a lot of talks and interviews with people that were like sex slaves and things like that for the government, for corporations. And, you know, had years go by without knowing, you know, waking up years later after having a whole other life. You know, I mean, that's maybe a little bit off the topic of where your research is and what you're going through. But it's all this is going to dovetail into one another, you know.
And it's really not off topic, because I didn't use sex slave, that terminology, in my book directly. Essentially, what they did to my ex-fiance was create a sex slave.
Mm-hmm.
And also, what's the greatest form of control? Is when you have somebody giving of their body.
Yeah, and actually a large part of brainwashing and control for a man or a woman, but it tends to be mostly women statistically, is rape. Rape's an excellent brainwashing tool and control tool. And in her case, and in a lot of other female victims' cases I've talked to, they're all basically experiencing the break-ins, the date rape drug, and physical rape along with electronic rape.
Yeah.
So what these criminals have found is they have an excellent tool that allows them to break into a home without getting caught, because you can use X-ray to imaging to scan the neighborhood. You can make sure your neighbors may be home, but as long as they're not looking out the window at your door, that makes for easy access into the home they want to break into. Put date rape drugs and whatever water or foodstuffs, food products you want to in the home, control that person to drink or eat where the drugs are. In as I mentioned in the book, in my ex-fiance's case, they were actually cutting the corner off of tea bags and putting Rohypnol in her tea bags, and would wake her up at midnight in the middle of the night. She'd start mixing a cup of tea and essentially mixing her own rape without even knowing it.
That's so heartbreaking. It's hard to take. It's hard to continue this interview for me. It's horrible. This is Satan at his best. And like I tell people, the only people that I know that make it through this are people who have faith.
You have to have faith. You have to have a belief in God, and you have to have faith. If you don't, every email that we get, Zeph, is, you know, what can I do? What can I do? And what's heartbreaking for John and I is there's not a whole lot we can do. The only thing we can do at this point is, you know, is pray. We just tell people to pray and create a spiritual life. Because one thing that we've discovered is if you are being manipulated, you're hearing the voices in your head and so forth, if you grab the book and you start reading scripture, it's really hard for somebody to manipulate you or to control you if you've got the word of God on your mouth, on your lips.
Mm-hmm. Well, I did, you know, happen to find you know, some scriptures as I was looking at, well, how are we going to cope? And I found one, it's just really conforming your mind to Christ, i.e. get rid of all other thoughts, bring every thought into subjection, you know, get the focus off ourselves and put it onto him. In other words, detach from our reactions to, let's say it is going on. But if we can somehow break through and just be, you know, be still and know that I am God, be at peace with him in that moment. And not be redirecting our thoughts back onto ourselves in either a critical manner or a self-hatred, self-loathing, suicidal. All those thoughts have to be directed somewhere else.
Absolutely.
And that's the problem.
To me, at least, I guess where I derive my spiritual you know, strength to combat this is from Ephesians. In my mind, I think Ephesians is the combat manual for electronic harassment, especially, you know, and one of the thing, reason I wrote this book was based on Ephesians when it says, take no part in the evil deeds of darkness, but rather expose them.
Yeah. So you take that reproving them, exposing them as a mandate for your really it's a ministry and an outreach. And at the same time, you've got a radio show that is tell us about the radio show and how that came about, where people can tune in.
Well, the reason that we started the radio show is to get the word out. We were, you know, it is our ministry. It's my ministry. I can't speak for John, but I feel pretty certain that he feels the same way. But it is my ministry, because there are so many broken people that are being controlled, that we started a radio show. We initially were on KTSA in San Antonio, which is a AM high-powered AM radio station in South Texas, and it goes all over South and Central Texas. And we did a one-hour show on a Saturday night, and basically, after we were on for about a month, they actually wanted us to leave because of all the negative things that were happening at the radio station. For instance, one night our board would be full of calls, and our board operator would be so frightened by what was being said and what was going on that he just took the phone off the hook and quit answering telephone calls. Yeah. And he was so frightened one night that he didn't even want to work any longer, because of some of the stuff what we did is initially we outed the NSA here in San Antonio. The DOD and NSA are just hugely prevalent in this part of the country in South Central Texas.
We have three NSA bases here now, including one's a former Sony Microchip corporation. And one's a foreign, believe it or not, a old Albertsons grocery store building. I mean, you can't swing a dead cat in San Antonio without hitting an NSA agent now. So,
and ultimately, what happened is after we'd outed them, the next day, if you're familiar with the radio business, there's a company called BMP or Border Media. They own a whole bunch of radio stations. In where KTSA is owned by Border Media. Anyway, they've got five stations out of this one building. 3 FM and 2 AM. And the next day after we did our show, all of the computers shut down, and they shut down the whole radio stations, all five of their radio stations. So we decided to, we got hooked up with RBN with Stattmiller and so forth, because mm-hmm. Stattmiller allows us to get the word out. And our show, thank God, is growing exponentially.
And it's called the control factor, and okay. The reason it's called that is not only do we deal with electronic harassment and control, but we deal with a lot of political issues, and we have a lot of the victims that listen to our show will call in when we'll do several days of political shows, saying, "Well, I thought you guys were talking about electronic harassment and mind control, and you know, well, the in our minds, the best way to combat this is to get some moral and ethical people placed in government." So we do cover, you know, a lot like healthcare bill things and who's running for Congress. And we've formed relationships with some really good guys who are running for House of Representatives and the Senate here out of Texas. You know, we've got to get some people with some ethical standards in government to be able to get the government to help us bring some disclosure to this. And so we're kind of attacking it from a bunch of different sides. And sometimes to our listeners, it seems like we're not covering the stuff they want to cover, but you know, there is a rhyme to the reason. So
yeah,
and so also we have to establish credibility, because Zeph, as you all know, being a TI, the first thing that goes is people say, oh, you're delusional, and yeah. that destroys and devastates your credibility. So what we're trying to do is we're going to backdoor this thing to get our congressional hearings to make John Q. Public aware of everything that's going on with the gang stalking and the mind control and just the satanic insanity that's happening with our government, is we've got to get involved politically, and we are. We're going to be involved politically, because and you know, the more favors you well know, the more favors you do for politicians, you know, you do them one, they owe you one, and that's kind of what we're doing, because it's heartbreaking to hear the stories and see the things that we see, and you lived it, so you understand, and John, Dr. Hall, has lived it. Fortunately, thank God, I haven't. And not to say that I haven't been followed and my phones haven't been zapped. And at one time, all three of our computers were taken down. And here recently, I've had three different cars follow me every place that I go and so forth.
But, so you are really, in a sense, experiencing it. I mean, you haven't up to this point, but now you're noticing it is going on, at least in a soft level.
I have. But you know what? I'm not fearful of it. I'm not afraid of it. And if they want to, bring it on. Just put me in the system and bring it on. Because for one, I've got, spiritually, I'm okay. I've put on my full suit of armor and I carry a great big sword and I'm ready, just bring it on. And I think that's what's, if you look at this situation in that manner, and I've seen the change in John, Dr. Hall as well. He is, we're in the forefront. We'll take the bullets. We're going to be on the firing line, and we're going to say things that a lot of people are afraid to say. And we're going to make a lot of people angry when we do it, but we have to. We don't have any choice.
No, there's at this point, there's no choice.
See, I've made plenty of people angry. The Texas Medical Board does not believe a word of this, and that's really what saddens me the most, is that each state medical board is pretty well keeping, out of fear, physicians from addressing this.
Well, here's on Chapter 17 of your book, speaking about the Texas Medical Board, it says, bleach and the Texas Medical Board, and here is what Dr. Hall says. What do bleach and the Texas Medical Board have in common? They've both been used by the ghost, which you'll read about when you get the book, to ruin me over the last couple of years. A year after hurdling the Methodist debacle, I received a package in the mail from the Texas Medical Board announcing their investigation into my loss of privileges. That's the kind of thing, and I'm not going to read it. That's just a little tidbit for you, but I mean, he goes into a whole bunch of, just literal biography about what has happened since he's been speaking up on this and trying to get to the bottom of it, getting good hard evidence against the perpetrators to expose this organized stalking and satellite surveillance and the ruination of people who, I guess, don't go along with the New World Order. I mean, that's what it's going to finally come down to, right? But who are just not, mind controllable or whatever it is. Obviously, you're kind of a rebel, wouldn't you say, John? You're like a rebel you're a maverick, if you will. You're not someone that is going to just stand down and be submissive and let them, try to make a deal with them, right?
Pretty much. And I get offered that just about on a daily basis. I have friends and family members who really don't believe any of this that are like, just even if it's happening, just forget it. It's happening. Try to ignore it. Don't keep on doing a radio show. Don't keep on publishing books. Just do what the medical board wants you to do. And, luckily there are a handful of other physicians in the United States that are finally coming around to seeing that, you have one or two people nationwide that are complaining of getting attacked by unseen weapons and hearing voices. Well, that's delusional. You have several thousand voicing exact duplicate complaints. That's not delusional disorder. That's a criminal problem. Delusional disorder, even according to the NIH, National Institutes of Health, has a percentile of 0.03% of the general population. That's not very many people, 0.03%. We've got several thousand people listed in Freedom from Covert Harassment and Surveillance, and there's a bunch of other organizations that are handling these victims' complaints. If you take the whole collection of people across the United States that are voicing these complaints, it's way more than 0.03%. And all of them, or just about all of them, are out of the age range to be diagnosed as schizophrenic. So, by statistics alone and sheer numbers, this is a criminal problem and not a mental illness problem. And it's time for physicians to speak up about it other than me. And we do have several. Colin Ross has linked it back to MK Ultra. He's a psychiatrist from Dallas. Dr. Terry Robertson out of Missouri has been on several radio shows with me and is also on the board of Freedom from Covert Harassment and Surveillance. Dr. Ed Spencer is a neurologist in California and did some exposure with Morgellons disease and how it possibly ties into this. So slowly there are some doctors coming forward, but Texas Medical Board is probably one of the worst in the nation as far as controlling the physicians and having no recourse once you're targeted by them. You know, their say is final. Even if you have a legal hearing and a judge rules in your case, the medical board doesn't have to abide by a legal ruling. And in most states, it's that way. So doctors are actually fearful of speaking out about this, because once you're even suggested at being delusional, you're going to find yourself, you know, on an order, having psych evals, having drug testing. And, you know, the drug testing is so stringent in most states that you can't even be on antihistamines and you know, just everyday over-the-counter things, poppy seeds and what have you, that if you know you're targeted and you wind up on one of these drug testing orders, I mean, it's easy to discredit you from then on, because, I mean, it's not a matter of putting an illegal drug in your system. It's a matter of dropping a Benadryl in something.
Yeah, make sure you have your bagel with cream cheese with a poppy seed bagel, you know, and then poppies show up.
Even as far as hair gel has alcohol in it. And if you got, what's the percentage, John, if you, you know, like, ether alcohol or whatever?
Yeah, well, most of these medical boards, ours included, they don't test for straight alcohol. They test for alcohol metabolites, ethyl glucuronide and ethyl sulfate. Any form of alcohol, not just ethanol, will raise those metabolites in your system. Mm-hmm. Once these perpetrators get a physician under an order where you're being drug tested, you know, you come back with a positive alcohol test, which can happen with the antiseptic gels, hand gels that are now being used since the swine flu, scare, hair gels, hairsprays. I mean, there's alcohol in everything. And all it takes is one positive dilute test with alcohol metabolites, and then you're unlicensed. And then just by being a doctor that's been disciplined and lost your license, that discredits you from the fight as well.
Don't you think that when people find out what's been happening to them, you know, eventually that there's relief that comes when they find out? I mean, they may not be able to answer why. I mean, I answer why by saying it's just Satan. You know, it's all Satanism. These are Satanists hardcore, and basically they want to recruit you. And if they can't recruit you, then you're this lamb to the slaughter. That's the way it works. That's my simplistic, you know, for years, that's what I would say about it. Not having the technical lingo or the jargon to actually, you know, scope it out as you have. But don't you think that people that find out that they're TIs, targeted individuals, isn't there some relief that follows?
Oh, sure. You know, knowledge is power, and that's what actually is on our logo for the control factor. And you can always spot the people who have recently become targeted when they email me, because they're thinking, you know, I've had people say, well, at first I thought it was angels speaking to me or God speaking to me, or I have an entity in my home, you know, and I'll email them back. And I said, well, you're right. It is satanic. It is demonic. And you do have an entity, but that entity sitting at a computer with a headset on and targeting you. You know, it's a human entity that's actually doing the technological part of it. But once you understand the technology, understand that, you know, the biggest concern with women is, and I've seen this multiple times, where they're afraid to take showers. They'll bathe with the lights off in their bathroom, because they know people can see them. It's X-ray imaging and it's thermal imaging. They're not seeing a sexual image of you unless they break in and hide, you know, pinhole cameras or real camera imaging in the home. Mm-hmm. So what they're actually seeing is an X-ray image. They're not getting a graphic sexual image of you when they watch you in your home. That's why the attacks can be so anatomically correct, because they're looking at an X-ray image, essentially. And once you explain this to people, it's that initial complete loss of privacy that really drives people crazy and changes their behavior. They start trying to line their houses with Mylar or shielding materials, which does no good. You know, wearing funky clothing or doing, like I've seen multiple women say, well, I'm taking a shower with the lights off because I know they can see me. Once they understand exactly the way the technology works, the best thing you can do is just try to ignore it, ignore the voices as they're coming into you, and live your life, because these people have created their own prison. They're working in 12-hour shifts. They're sitting in a room at a computer watching you all day long. Live your life. Have a good time. You know, make them wish they hadn't have made that choice, because they are having to sit in a room to watch you.
It's hard to imagine. Of course, there are probably some people that would like to know where those rooms are. perhaps...
We actually know where at least one is.
Okay. Well, I mean, but you guys are under control. I mean, you get someone who's, you know, they find out this has been going on. You mentioned this case in, was it Tennessee, where guy had an appendectomy, and he goes back, and there was a shooting, and all the press reports is on a shooting, but not the details.
Right.
Would you care to elaborate or get your thoughts on that?
And sure. And we checked our records through Freedom from Covert Harassment and Surveillance, and I checked my emails because I've heard from literally thousands of victims. And that individual, you know, never presented himself to either one of our organizations. I wish he had, and this probably wouldn't have happened. But he had an appendectomy, felt like he had been chipped by the surgeon, started being harassed, and felt like he was being tracked through the chip, and finally just had enough and went to the hospital, actually with the intent to shoot the surgeon that did the appendectomy. Now, the surgeon wasn't there, so he wound up, you know, shooting three people that probably, you know, had nothing to do with it. And in reality, the surgeon probably had nothing to do with it as well. One thing I want to make clear to your listeners, this type of harassment, you don't have to have a chip in you for it to happen. It's done through EEG fingerprinting or brain fingerprinting, through biosensing satellites that can pick up individual frequencies. The biggest fallacy in belief in the victims is that you have to have a homing beacon or some type of microchip in you for them to target you, and that's just simply not true. They want you to believe that because that's also something that's going to drive you crazy and make you do something to discredit yourself.
Right. I know they want that. They want you to either get in trouble with the law and thereby be jailed or kill yourself, which is win-win for them, or wind up in a mental hospital, wind up being unemployable and destitute. All those are the kind of goals that they have. And then I used to ask why. And the answer came back from some of them that I had talked to, because we can. And there's also a witchcraft component to this. I want to just add this possibility because there's a lot of people out there who have coming at it from the spiritual angle. There's a witchcraft component to it that deals with stealing people's talent, stealing your soul, stealing stuff that you've got. And it's very difficult to describe this, but it is, they are piling on as well. There's a witchcraft component to it. And eventually I think we're going to have information that weds, you know, spiritual warfare, the things of the spirit, spiritual technology, and this technology. I mean, I see it moving that way, that where the occult and this are being wedded. It will be understood later. Well, let's go over this. The symptoms, how would someone know they are a TI? Some of the symptoms we mentioned before, like you close your eyes, you have lights. Some people I talked to used to think they were seeing angels.
Yeah, that's actually called phosphenes. And there's actually I'm writing a second book called Guinea Pigs right now that's going to go into the technology of that a little more. But when you expose the human brain to electromagnetic energy, it will, one part of the brain that actually is very sensitive to electromagnetic energy is the optic nerve and the optical cortex of the brain. And one thing that almost happens with 100% of human guinea pigs with electromagnetic radiation are called phosphenes, and that's the flashes of light that you see in the periphery. Not only with your eyes closed, but can also happen with your eyes open. Mm-hmm. Bright streaking flashes of light, and that is called phosphenes.
And what does that mean if someone has that symptom? If it's an ongoing problem?
It means you're being bombarded with electromagnetic energy. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's coming from attack. I mean, if you live near a cell phone tower or high power lines, or you happen to have some appliances that are leaky or not constructed well, that can also cause it. But if you're having that in addition to having your home broken into and, some other symptoms, then that would lend itself more to attack. But some of the symptoms to look for are that we see most commonly are severe headaches, a lot of times to the back of the head, the suboccipit or the occipital area of the skull, at the base of the skull in the rear. There's a large cluster of nerves called the occipital nerves that come out of the base of the skull. They're right under the surface. They're very easy to hit. Most victims will describe that as it feels like somebody taking two battery cables to the back of your head. It's very obviously coming from the outside and not a physiologic headache like you would have a migraine or something. Muscle twitching, full limb twitching. They'll make you lose control of your arm or your leg, and it'll twitch uncontrollably. And when I say this, these aren't the type of twitches you have like if you're a runner or after you're working out that, you know, you can discern between normal physiologic muscle spasms and twitching, between something coming from the outside and stimulating that muscle to twitch. Heart palpitations, another real common one is severe heartburn. When you attack the stomach lining, the esophageal lining with microwave energy, it heats it up spontaneously. It causes a large amount of reflux. One way to tell when it's attack and not physiologic reflux is when they stop attacking you with the microwave energy, it goes away spontaneously. Most people with reflux or GERD, you know, gastroesophageal reflux disease, will tell you that even with treatment, even when you take Nexium or an antacid, it still takes a few hours for that heartburn to subside. When it's microwave-induced heartburn, it is quick on and quick off. As soon as they stop attacking the lining, it settles right back down. It's a thermal effect of the microwave.
Unbelievable. I'm sure there's a lot of people out there right now just saying, I wonder if I'm one of them. Any other, you know, just really sure telltale signs that a person might be stocked?
If you're having those type of symptoms and you're noticing break-ins, and the break-ins usually don't result in theft. These people don't want to bring a felony burglary charge against themselves because that'll get an investigation. Usually what happens is they'll break in, they'll take your appliances apart, put them back together, usually intentionally put them back together wrong or slightly damaged because they want you to know it's been done. Vandalize your home without stealing anything. That's part of this whole psychological operation of putting you in a victim mentality they're going to get into your home and there's nothing you can do about it. When they take the appliances apart, you probably is a good idea to have those frequency scanned or have a bug check done by a PI that you trust. Especially if it's sexual assault based, somewhere in your home, they'll usually try to put a low-tech radio frequency based camera in to get true camera imaging in the home. But 9 times out of 10, the taking apart of the appliances and everything is to make you believe that they've installed cameras in the home when they haven't. Because what happens invariably is the victim will call the police, tell them, well, somebody broke into my house, they didn't steal anything, but they took all my appliances back together, apart and put them back together wrong. Well, that also gets you a mental diagnosis, and the police start discrediting you. And once the police discredit you, they can break into your house and do whatever they want because you're going to call the police and they're not going to come. So that's another thing to look for. And of course, the stalking. I know, are you being followed by the same people all the time? And this type of organized stalking isn't surveillance from a distance that you kind of wonder, well, I think that person's watching me. It's harassment-based stalking. It's people right on your bumper, shooting you the finger while they drive around you multiple times, standing at the door of your home until you drive up the driveway. I mean, it's very obvious harassment.
Wow. And designed to get someone to then go report to, you know, someone and if they get referred to a shrink or something like that, you know, aren't some of these shrinks and some of these people that they get referred to part of it as well?
In San Antonio, there is one psychiatrist that we know for a fact is part of it. And it's amazing how many of the victims in our area end up being referred to the same guy. He's a part of it. And if you look back at MK Ultra and most of the mind control studies, psychiatrists have been at the forefront of researching this technology. Now, that's not to say that your local community psychiatrist probably is not involved in most cases. He's probably just uneducated as to the extent of the technology. My problem with psychiatry, and I am a medical doctor, I don't necessarily consider psychiatry a true field of medicine for the sheer fact that basically you're going to someone, you're telling them a story. If they believe it, you're okay. If they don't believe it, you're crazy. There's no objective findings.
Yeah. Well,
to psychiatry. That would be like me. I do anesthesia and pain management. You know, for me to put a needle in your back, I have to show diagnosis of a herniated disc, you know, or a nerve root problem in your spine. You know, you can't come to me and say, well, I'm having a little back pain, and I can't just say, oh, yeah, you need a shot. Mm-hmm. I have to have objective findings. And psychiatry really so far in this country is still in the Middle Ages. And what's even more worrisome is if you look in the past, it's been presidents of the American Psychiatric Association and some of the top dogs in the psychiatric community that have been at the forefront of mind control research.
Yeah, and I've run into quite a few of those. I know the pantheon, and also the ones who have passed on and contributed to the arcane practices of getting control of people, which is really what it is. They have the ability to write prescriptions and to put you in a hospital. And then usually it becomes a control thing. And, you know, you go on good behavior in order to get out. But you're always on that string, you know, being analyzed. And so, you know, and then there's a lot of people that, are, you know, they split and become multiple personalities, but not because of so much of the being put into a hospital or something. It's because of the trauma that occurs to them while they're there. And the fact that they don't understand, so they split and they split and they split in order to cope. And then you find one of these, and a lot of these have been TIs, and they're traumatized. They're traumatized by this whole game, and that's why they split. And then the shrink looks at him and says, oh, well, we need to reintegrate you so you'll be healthy again. You know, it's because you're avoiding looking at an illness or something that happened or a trauma in your life. We have to face those traumas in order to heal you so that we can return you to the community.
Well, and you know, we had a case here in San Antonio that a man who was actually in anesthesia residency here at the medical school in San Antonio, who began getting harassed. And he described what most victims describe, which is he was hearing voices. At first, he thought it was his neighbors outside the window. You know, it was real faint voices. And then after he started focusing on it a little more, they noticed they were talking about him and his placement in the house, what he was doing, what he was thinking. He voiced these complaints while he was in residency. This man never even had a shot at getting a license in the state of Texas. During his residency, they referred him for psychiatric treatment. It went as far as him actually being locked up and having, you know, in-house psychiatric treatment, not just seeing a counselor, and placed him on meds, did psychotherapy. And one thing that he told me was that he said, you know what, after, you know, even after weeks of in-house therapy and treatment and them trying to diagnose me, all they focused on was the fact that I was hearing voices. Not one psychiatrist ever asked him what the voices were saying.
Wow.
And, you know, if you look at reports from people who do have schizophrenia, the voices they're hearing usually sound like multiple voices on a subway, you know, or it's, you know, it's multiple angels telling them to stand on a mountain and proclaim mm-hmm. the word of God. And I mean, they'll describe it as, you know, hard to hear, muffled, multiple voices. It's usually not, you know, the voice of one or two individuals that you hear every time. The voices are the same. A lot of times you can hear the background noise where the people are actually doing the harassment from. Jets fly over and things that are in the background where the broadcast are coming from. Hear them change shifts, talk about your position in a room, where you're at, what you're doing, what they're going to do to you. And when you hear that over and over, that's just not mental illness, you know. And at some point, the psychiatric community is going to have to be educated to realize and to admit that there's technology now that can do this. And if you look at the Army's addendum to the bioeffects of non-lethal weapons, that came out in 96 through Freedom of Information, and it clearly states that with microwave hearing, they now have the ability to put voices in the head of enemy combatants. And I quote, it says, imagine the disconcerting effects when an enemy combatant begins to hear voices in his own head that are not his own. And they go in to talk about its value in hostage situations where they can communicate with the hostage taker or the hostages without anyone else other than that targeted person hearing. So, I mean, you know, the scientific literature is out there on the technology, and it's still being largely ignored by the psychiatric community.
It's so horrifying. I mean, so now here you are in the community of San Antonio, and you're not afraid to say that. How is it going? You know, just being there and, you know, having your life outside work.
You know, it's great. Life is great. It really is. I think part of it, too, Zeph, is the fact that John and I are not fearful. And it's really difficult to control somebody that is not fearful. You know, part of control is the fear factor, the fear of the unknown, the fear of the boogeyman, the fear of the, you know, the monster in the closet or underneath the bed. that's always been a form of control. You know, and if you don't show that fear, or if you, honest to God, don't have that fear, you know, it doesn't matter to you. What can they do? You know, they can discredit us. You know, I'm 54 years old, man. I don't care. If I was 24, I might care if you tried to discredit me.
You guys are making me feel bad here. How old am I, Trish? Oh.
How old?
I'm 56. I can't believe I got to be 56. But then again, I look at that as a victory.
So do I, brother.
Because I've been fighting these people since I was about 4, you know, and I have to tell you, it hasn't been very pleasant. And, you know, at one point I wound up in a coma. I've given my testimony before. I'm not going to, you know, take it up here. But it's just that, you know, I'm kind of happy myself because I realize, you know what, I'm sitting here on the radio. I'm talking to you guys, which is, believe me, a blessing. And if it's as much a blessing to you folks out there as it is to me, to find other like-minded, like-spirited people, that to me is a healing. You know, it's not just me, Zeph, telling you out there. Here we are, three of us having this discussion, and we're all exactly on the same page, came from completely different walks of life and completely different experiences, coming into a common cause. And I've got to say that's a victory.
Amen. I agree with you. And I think that's where the joy comes from is victory. You know, we have a victory in our spiritual life, and we have a victory in Christ, and through having a victory in Christ, that's where your joy comes from, and that's why you can't, you know what, I've always been an entrepreneur, I've made lots of business mistakes, I've made a whole lot of money and lost a whole lot of money, and had big things and lost them, and had little things and lost them, and mm-hmm. get them all back, and you know what, there's not much else that you can do. You know, what are you going to do? You're going to take my life? If you do, I'm going to go see the Lord. I'm okay with that.
Yes, as the apostle said, you know, to live, to die is gain, to live is Christ, or to live is Christ, to die is gain. Eventually that, without the Lord, I wouldn't be here right now. That's what I've got to say that. We're all out of time. Please, gentlemen, stay right there, and I'll be talking to you right now. I've got to wrap the show right now because we're right on the end of it, folks, and I will continue with you. Thank you so much for being there, Don Raumaker and Dr. John Hall. Thank you. And, well, what do you think? You think we're, you know, one or two people is crazy, but then when you get all these people putting all the puzzle together, that's what's happening today. The book is called A New Breed, Satellite Terrorism in America by Dr. John Hall. And it's, wow, what a read it is. Look, if you're like me, you're going to just soak this book up. Go to Amazon.com. And there's a website. I can't remember right now because I'm right on the end. And I will see you. We'll see you next week on Z Live. And I'll see you during the week at the ZephReport.com podcast and on my music site if you happen to get there.